Well, good morning and a very warm welcome to you all to a lovely warm church on a beautiful sunny morning. We won't talk about the wind, but it's good. It's not snow. It's not rain. It's all good. It's a beautiful day, isn't it? And what a lovely song we've just been listening to. See, he lives. Christ is risen from the dead, as we celebrated our Easter Sunday last Sunday. We're going to continue the theme for that this morning at this all-age service as Tim Britton comes and speaks to us as we follow on from the resurrection. And the theme this morning is seeing and believing. So we're going to continue with that later on. As I say, this is an all-age service, so we want you to be comfortable. The children will be staying in. I think most of them must be on holiday. There are some here. Great to see you. And as I say, we hope you'll enjoy being with us this morning, whether you're regular here or whether you're just visiting us this morning. This is going to be a service where we'll share the Lord's Supper later on, and I'll give you instructions as to how that works at this particular church, because with the C of E, we all do the same, but we all do it differently. So I'll explain a little bit more about that later on. Just a few notices as we begin. Most of you will actually get the weekly email from Mary Pallister with the Cromer Church weekly update with everything in it. There's lots and lots in. I've just picked three things to draw your attention to, but there's lots more going on. So if you haven't read it, go home and read it again and make a note of all the different dates and things to put in your diary. And God willing, there'll still be some paper copies available at the back of the church, unless the 845 congregation have taken them all. But there should be some at the back by the door as you came in. Well, the first notice is for this coming Thursday at St. Martin's at 7:30. One of our mission partners, Hope Into Action, is sending a lady called Debs, who's going to come and speak to us about their work and how we can get more involved as a church or individually. So if you're able to go along to that, please do. At 7:30 on Thursday at our church, St. Martin's in Mill Road. The second service is, a second notice rather, is a bit more advanced than that. It's just a reminder to those of you who come along to the midweek communion service. I'm sure a lot of people will have missed that since we've had all the work done in the parish church. But we are going to resume the week Wednesday morning services at 10 o'clock in the prayer chapel, but not till the 17th of April. Okay, so it's a week on Wednesday. Week on Wednesday that resumes. And finally, for the gentlemen, this is even further advanced. Saturday, 20th of April. If you like a cooked breakfast and you're able to get up at 8 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday to go and have one, Paul Rosier is going to be our guest speaker. Many of you will know he's a judge as well as a minister. And so please do go along and hear how his faith has affected his life and how it's played a part in what he does in administering justice and other things, I'm sure. If you'd like to go along to that, to help with catering, it would be really helpful if you could let Tim Britton here, who's behind me, if you could let him know either by phone, email, or perhaps not in person, because he might forget, probably rather have it written down, that you'd like to go, that'd be wonderful, especially if you've got a dietary requirement so we can cater for you. So gentlemen, 8 o'clock, Saturday the 20th of April, at the parish hall, that one is. Okay, well, I think that's all the notices for now, but as I say, there are lots more things going on, so do look at the update. But as Rita comes up, because Rita's going to pray the Cromer prayer for us in a moment, but as she comes up to do that, come on, Rita, you come up. As you come up, we're going to pray the prayer for today, that's set for today. Come this way, Rita, that's good. So I'm going to pray the Church of England prayer for today, and then Rita's going to pray for us. So let's pray. Risen Christ, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the doors of our hearts, that we may seek the good of others and walk the joyful road of sacrifice and peace, to the praise of God the Father. Amen. We can't do that on our own, so Rita's going to pray for the Holy Spirit's help with that. So Rita, over to you, into the microphone. Great.
Lord, pour your Holy Spirit on Cromer, Lord, pour your Holy Spirit on the church. Lord, pour your Holy Spirit on everybody here. Amen.
Amen. As I say, we do need the Holy Spirit's help because we are not perfect until we go to heaven and be with the Lord Jesus. We're not fully perfect. We just have to work towards perfection. But none of us are Jesus themselves, so we just have him living in us. So we're going to stand as we sing our opening song now. It's a wonderful old hymn, but it's very pertinent to what we're singing, listening to and hearing about today. So. Please do sit down. We're going to have a time where we say sorry to God for the things that we need to say sorry for. Each one of us will have thought, said or done something that doesn't bring glory to God and doesn't really say a lot for us either. Sometimes only we know those things that we have done that we shouldn't. So with our confession this morning, perhaps when the words, when I say, Lord, have mercy, would you repeat, Lord, have mercy after me? And then there's Christ, have mercy, and then Christ, have mercy. So the words are in bold. Please do join in as we go along. So like Mary at the empty tomb, we fail to grasp the wonder of your presence. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Like the disciples behind locked doors, we are afraid to be seen as your followers. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Like Thomas in the upper room, we are slow to believe. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. So may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So we're going to respond to that forgiveness now as we stand to sing again.
We have a stronger
Tim is going to be sharing, please do sit down, sorry, sharing something about us knowing individually what it is for God to be, for Jesus to be alive in our hearts later on. But first we're going to hear from our Bible reading, and Alison is coming to read to us this morning. So Alison, are you ready? I've got the page open to the right place.
The reading this morning. The reading this morning is from John chapter 20, beginning at verse 24. It will be on the screen, and if you want to follow it in the Bibles, it can be found on page 1089. John 20, verses 24 to 29. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. It's nice to see you all here today. And today we're thinking about seeing and believing. Let's pray before we start. Lord, we cannot truly see unless your Spirit opens our eyes. And so we pray that you would pour out your Spirit upon us, encourage us, strengthen our faith. May we truly believe the story of Jesus' resurrection. And believing, we pray that we may live it out for Jesus' sake. Amen. We're going to start with thinking about that first Easter Sunday. We want to imagine that scene in the upper room where the small crowd of disciples were together in the house that Sunday evening, all of them followers of Jesus. And the doors of the house were locked because they were afraid that what had happened to Jesus might happen to them. Now, the Thursday before that Sunday evening, their leaders had arrested Jesus and put him on trial. And on Friday, Jesus had been condemned to a horrible death on the cross, nailed to the cross. And Jesus' death must have been a terrible shock to the disciples, to the followers. But that Sunday morning, some women had rushed into the house where they were with an unbelievable story. They said they'd gone to the tomb. And it was a rock tomb, and they'd seen Jesus' body laid in that cave in the tomb. And the stone, which we see beside the tomb, had been rolled across the entrance. They'd watched that happen, no doubt. But then when they went to the tomb that Sunday morning, they discovered that the stone had been rolled away from the tomb. And when they went into the tomb, they then saw that it was empty, apart from the grave clothes that were still there. One of the women, Mary Magdalene, ran back and told the disciples what they had seen. And the disciples, well, two of them, Peter and John, ran there and found that it was exactly what they had said. Now, Mary herself followed, and she stood outside weeping. She thought the body had been taken by somebody and was overcome by grief. But as she was crying, she heard somebody calling her name, and it was Jesus himself, risen from the dead. And Jesus went and told the disciples what she'd seen and what Jesus had said to her. And other women said they'd seen him as well. But that was impossible. How could they have seen Jesus alive? He had been crucified. He was dead. He'd been buried. He definitely died. And people don't come back from the dead just like that. But then later that day, Peter came into the room. And he said that he'd also seen Jesus. We don't know what Jesus said to him, but Peter said he'd seen him. And they had to believe Peter. And then, after that, a couple came, who had gone to Emmaus, they came in, and they said that they'd met Jesus on their walk, and they'd even invited him home and got a meal ready for him. That was incredible news. What had happened? And then as they were talking about this, suddenly they all became aware that someone else was there, and that person was Jesus himself. But how'd he got there? The doors were locked. But Jesus showed them the marks of the wounds in his hands and side. And Luke tells us that he invited them to touch him and to see he wasn't a ghost. He had flesh and bones, and he even ate a piece of fish. Apparently, I don't know it, but ghosts don't do that kind of thing. Jesus really was alive. But one of his disciples, Thomas, wasn't there. And in spite of everything the disciples told him, despite the evidence of the empty tomb, Thomas couldn't bring himself to believe. Dead people don't come back to life. And so he told them, unless I see for myself the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand in his side where the spear had gone in, I will not believe. Was Thomas right to be so doubtful? Let's remind ourselves of the facts that Thomas had been told. You might, those of you who are members of the Open the Book team, or if you've been to the junior school for the last assembly before Easter, you will recognize we have the very stone here. The stone that was rolled in front of the tomb and had been rolled back somehow. But we're going to use it as a kind of a jigsaw, with the facts on the outside, and then seeing what explanation might fit the facts in the middle. So the first fact that we know was that the stone had been rolled away. I'm hoping that this will all fit together. The stone had been rolled away. How? There'd been a guard there. And yet, for some reason, those guards had run away. Why? Would they have run away just from friends coming to see the grave and open? They wouldn't have run away from that, nor would they have run away from grave robbers. They had been told to watch carefully just in case something happened. And something had happened. The stone was rolled away. It must have been something supernatural. The next piece of evidence we see is that when people went into the tomb, there was no body there. Just the grave clothes. Now, how could that be? Why were the grave clothes still in the tomb without a body? And then the third piece of evidence that Thomas would have been told was this. His friends told him very clearly that they had seen Jesus, they'd spoken with him, they'd touched him, they'd seen him eat a piece of fish. Could he believe his friends? Well, what explanations could there be? Well, one explanation that people come up with to try and explain away the resurrection was that Jesus was not dead. They say that maybe on the cross he had merely fainted and he was unconscious and looked dead. And that when he got into the tomb or been put in the tomb, he revived. And then somehow he had managed to roll away the heavy stone from the inside with no purchase on it. And then, well, he must have come out of his grave clothes and left them in the tomb and come out presumably naked and then gone to his disciples and said, look, I'm alive. It didn't happen like that. It couldn't have happened like that. The soldiers were professional soldiers. They knew how to crucify people and they knew that Jesus truly was dead and buried. This explanation does not fit the facts. Well, another explanation that was current at the time was that Jesus's body had been stolen. But who by? Would grave robbers have stolen it? Would his friends have stolen his body? What about the guard? And if you were going to steal a body, would you unwrap it first and leave the grave clothes in the tomb? This explanation just does not fit the facts. A third thing, perhaps, that Thomas might have thought was that this whole story had been made up by the disciples. And that's a fairly current one nowadays, isn't it? People say we read the gospel stories and it's just a story. It didn't really happen. The earliest record of the resurrection we find in Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, which was written 20, 30 years after the crucifixion. And in that record, he says that at one time, Jesus appeared to more than 500 people at a time, most of whom are still alive, Paul said. Now, that is difficult to square with a made-up story. If it was made up, then people, when the disciples were saying that they'd seen Jesus alive, they would say, no, he couldn't. Look, there's his tomb. Look, there's his body. He's not alive. But they couldn't do it. The tomb was empty, and people had seen him, and they were changed. This does not fit the facts. What does fit the facts? I think the only logical explanation is that Jesus is alive. That's the only rational explanation for the facts that we have before us at the moment. There are all sorts of other things. There's This is the complete jigsaw. Jesus is alive. That fits the facts. There are other facts we could have mentioned, but these are what Thomas knew. There's a long bit. That's coming up later. These are the facts. This is the explanation. And it's the only explanation that fits the facts. Now, Thomas knew that. But he still couldn't believe that Jesus had risen from the dead. I mean, maybe there are people here who see what the story says, have been convinced that that's true, but they still can't believe. People don't rise from the dead. Too good to be true. But our reading tells us what happened a week later when the disciples were again in the upper room and Thomas this time was with them. And suddenly, just like the week before, they realized that somebody else was there. And that person was Jesus. How'd he got there? Doors were still locked, but he was there anyway. And he said, "Peace be with you," the usual greeting at that time. And then he looked at Thomas. "Thomas, come here. Put your finger here in my hand. Reach out your hand, put it in my side." Do you remember what Thomas had said? "Unless I see for myself the nail marks in his hands, put my finger where the nails were, put my hand in his side where the spear had gone in, I will not believe." Jesus knew exactly what Thomas had said. And here he was saying, "Come on, Thomas." Notice he didn't rebuke Thomas. He did say, "Stop doubting and believe." But he didn't really accuse him and tell him off in any way, because he loved Thomas and he knew what had been going through Thomas's mind. He understood him just like he understands each one of us too. But the great thing was, how did Thomas react? Here we are, last one going up. "My Lord and my God." That's what Thomas said. And that's what Jesus wants every one of us to say as well. We don't just say, "You are Lord and God," but we say, "You are my Lord and my God." Because if Jesus is not Lord of all, he is not Lord at all. Jesus' resurrection shows that he is indeed Lord and God. It shows us, of course, that his death, the death of the body, is not the end of life. And that's something that we can all rejoice in. But it shows so much more. If God raised Jesus from the dead, that shows that Jesus was pure and sinless in God's sight. He had never said or done anything wrong. When he was being crucified, God was not punishing him for anything he had done or said. If Jesus had done something wrong, well, he wouldn't have been fit to be in the presence of God. God would not have raised him from the dead. But if Jesus never said anything wrong, that means that what he said about himself and what he taught and promised was absolutely true, and we can rely on them completely. He claimed to be the Son of God. He claimed to be God's promised King, the Messiah. He claimed to be doing and teaching exactly what God wanted, and he was right to make those claims. He is Lord and God. But true faith doesn't just say that. It says to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." That's important. Because if Jesus is Lord and God, it's only right to accept him for who he is, and to give him full authority over every part of our lives. I read this passage when I was age 19, and it really struck home, and it struck him that I really had to do that, to give myself completely to Jesus. Let him have all authority over me. I couldn't do it. Not for several months. And then one night, it was just the right thing to do, and I did it. And when I did it, I got that sense that God had accepted me, that I now belonged to him, that Jesus was not just Lord, he was my shepherd. He would look after me and lead me to be with God forever. If somebody does something for us, then we don't have to do it ourselves. And this is an important truth that this resurrection, death and resurrection of Jesus tells us, because Jesus didn't die for himself. He died for us. Jesus didn't rise again for himself with a new life. He rose for us. And just as if somebody does something for us, we simply have to accept it gratefully. So it is with Jesus. We simply need to accept him and what he's done for us gratefully. And when Thomas said, "My Lord and my God," that was what he was doing. He was accepting Jesus for who he is. And he was also accepting all that Jesus had done for him, even if he didn't fully understand what it all was. He didn't know all the details. When Jesus died on the cross, he died for us, and he was taking the proper punishment for all the wrong things we have ever done. And when Jesus rose from the dead, that showed that all the sins that we've ever done have been fully paid for. If not, he wouldn't have risen from the dead. We don't have to pay for our sin, for any of our sin, ourselves. When we accept Jesus as our Lord and our God, then we accept his death for us. And we accept that because Jesus died for us and paid the punishment for our sins, we are now pure and sinless as far as God is concerned. But that's not all. Jesus rose from the dead. And he rose from the dead with a new kind of life, a kind of life that is free from all wrong and will never die again. And he did that for us. When we accept Jesus as our Lord and God, we are accepting also with him his gift of eternal life with God. Jesus used the illustration of branches in a grapevine. I am the vine, you are the branches. The branches share the life of the vine. And we now share Jesus' resurrection life. His life is in us. And he gives us his Holy Spirit to live in us and to help us live out the new life we have received so that we can be spiritually fruitful. But we do need to accept that gift. It's worthless unless we receive it. And we have, if we've believed in Jesus, if we've received Jesus into our lives, we have accepted also that gift of resurrection life to be lived even here on earth as best we can. And his Spirit helps us to do that. Jesus gives us his Spirit. Now I know that I belong to Jesus. He is my Lord and my God. Is he yours? It may be that there are some people here who haven't actually made that decision yet, haven't invited him into your life. Well, do so. It's the only logical response to these events. Invite Jesus into your life as your Lord and your God, your Savior. And it may be there are some people here who have done so, but you've drifted. There are now things in your life that you know that are not what Jesus wants. He's not Lord over that. today's the day to come back and to rekindle that love for Jesus and that trust in him and receive again for yourself his total forgiveness and his total full life. Thomas believed because he saw Jesus alive from the dead. Jesus then told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have believed. May we all know that blessing. Hallelujah! Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah! Amen.
I am on. Yes, can you hear me now? Yeah, great. Well, this is a wonderful opportunity because we're going to sing again now. For those of us who can say that the Lord is my God and my Lord, we can do the only thing possible to do, which is fall at his feet, metaphorically or physically, depending on how you're feeling. But for those of you who perhaps haven't yet made that decision, or perhaps the Lord has spoken to you through Tim's words this morning and you are able to now do so, perhaps we can use that as a time to reflect and to just, ask the Holy Spirit to help you make that decision today. So as the band leads us, let's stand if we're able as we sing and fall at God's feet. Please do sit down. because we're going to affirm our faith now as we declare our faith in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, as we say together these words, which will be on the screen. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried. He was raised to life on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Afterwards, he appeared to his followers and to all the apostles. This we have received, and this we believe. Amen. Now, Alison is going to come and lead us in our prayers.
Let's pray. First, a prayer written by John Wesley. Lord God, creator of the universe, you who care for all your children, we praise you for your wisdom and power which are beyond our thoughts, and trust you for your infinite goodness and love, which support us every day of our lives. We offer our thanksgiving for all the things you ask us to do. Make us more worthy to serve you and more willing to do your will. Lord, let us not live to be useless. Amen. We can determine that whatever we may do each day will be done in the name of Jesus and to the glory of God. Lord, we ask your help that nothing mean or shoddy or unworthy will be part of our work. Only those things in line with your will are offered to you. And that when we have done our best, we will trust the outcome and the result to you. Amen. We can be quiet in the presence of God. The Lord shows us what this means. Lord, take from our souls all strain and stress, all useless fuss. Let there be order and economy in everything we do, rather than confusion and wasted time and wasted energy, so that we find time for prayer and for praise and for gratitude for your infinite goodness. Amen. Lord, we can be ourselves, not attempting to present a mask or a facade to those we meet. So we ask your help, so that it is no longer we who live, but Christ who lives in us. So that we truly discover what it means to be children of God, made in his own image. So that there will be no place for personal aggression or the wrong kind of pride in anything we do. Amen. Lord, help us to live each day in such a way that we think more of others than we think about ourselves, serving them and loving them in your name. May this be true today, Lord. Amen.
Well, thank you, Alison. Please could I invite those of you who can to stand. Well, as we heard in our Bible reading, the risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad and they saw the Lord. May the peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Let's offer one another a sign of God's peace. Yes, just to the side. Wait, thank you. That will have to go that way later. Thank you. Peace be with you. Well, we're going to sing again now. I think when we get Terry back on his guitar, I think Terry's the only one missing, but the band are going to play for us again as we turn our thoughts to what it cost Jesus to die on the cross for us so that we might have that eternal life and be resurrected with him when our time comes. That's right, and I'm going to prepare the communion table as we do that, so that's great. Thank you, Terry. We're going to sing again.
Table on the king.
Sit down. We are coming towards the time when we share the bread and the wine, and we remember with gratitude Jesus' death on the cross and all that achieved for us. But as we come forward to receive this morning, let's come with joyful hearts, a smile on our face. So it's good to remember. It's good to remember all that it cost the Lord Jesus. But we do have the joy of the Lord in us, and that's what he came to bring, life in abundance, in all its abundance. We have so many reasons to be joyful this morning. Well, for those of you who don't have not been here before, perhaps, or haven't been for a while, I just want to just do the formalities before we actually start the communion prayer. And that's to say that the bread we're using is all gluten-free, so that's okay if you have an intolerance. We also have wine in the common cup and in individual goblets, whichever you prefer. In the individual goblet tray, the clear goblets are actually non-alcoholic wine. So if you'd prefer to receive non-alcoholic wine, take one of the clear goblets from the centre of the tray. If you take one of the individual ones, perhaps if you'd be good enough to put the goblet, when you've consumed the wine, in the trays at the back on the chairs at either end of the altar rail. We're only going to use the top rail today because we aren't so many as we were last week. And if for any reason that you don't feel able to come, or you're not physically able to come and receive, if you let Ivan know, Ivan will make sure that we come and serve you with communion at the end of the administration for those who are coming forward. And Ivan or somebody will be directing you he'll be directing you. So come forward as directed when it comes to that time. If you'd prefer not to receive communion but would like a prayer of blessing, and please perhaps just keep your hands to your side, and either Tim or myself will be happy to pray for you this morning. But we just look forward to sharing the Lord's Supper together with one another. So we remember with joy that the Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Almighty God, good Father to us all, your face is turned towards your world. In love you gave us Jesus, your Son, to rescue us from sin and death. Your word goes out to call us home to the city where angels sing your praise. We join with them in heaven's song as we say together, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Father of all, we give you thanks for every gift that comes from heaven. To the darkness, Jesus came as your light. With signs of faith and words of hope, he touched untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. The crowds came out to see your son, yet at the end they turned on him. On the night he was betrayed, he came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. Jesus blessed you, Father, for the food. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it and said, This is my body broken for you. Jesus then gave thanks for the wine. He took the cup and said, This is my blood shed for you all. For the forgiveness of sins, do this in remembrance of me. Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate the cross on which he died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you to plead for us and all the world. Send your Spirit on us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ. With opened eyes and hearts on fire, may we and all who share this food offer ourselves to live for you and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessing and honor and glory and powers be yours forever and ever. Amen. So as our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. And now my servers will come forward, and while we prepare ourselves, and then Ivan will direct you to the table when we're done. So, thank you.
Precious sign. anybody knows him.
Well, let's say thank you to the Lord as we pray together. Wait for the words. Let's pray. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, well, we sang this hymn to finish last Sunday on Easter Day. I said to the 845 congregation, this hymn cannot be sung often enough from my point of view. And I've probably told you several times before that this is one of my three funeral hymns. But it's very pertinent to today's passage particularly. So let's stand as we give God the glory. Wonderful, wonderful hymn. It always makes me smile, even though when I think of it, I always think, my funeral. But I just think, well, lo, Jesus meets us, risen from the tomb. I just can't wait to see him face to face. Although that might mean I have to leave you sooner rather than later, if that were the case. But anyway, that's just a joy, just a joy. So thank you so much for being with us. If you don't have to rush away, there's teas and coffees and biscuits served at the far corner of the church over there. But as we go, let's go with a prayer for God's blessing. The Lord loves us all, even me, okay? He even loves me, and I know I'm silly. But anyway, God the Father, by whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthen us to walk with him in his risen life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us all evermore. Amen. Amen. So let's go in peace to love, serve, and to enjoy the Lord Jesus. In the name of Christ, amen. Thank you.